Today I want to show you, give you an introduction or a presentation to a special solid body effect, the so-called piezoelectric effect. And it's called a description of an indispensable solid state effect for smart actuator and sensor technologies using the example of low temperature modification of quartz. My name is Rüdiger Ballas, and I'm professor for electrical engineering at the Mobile University of Technology located in Darmstadt, Germany. Now, let me give you a short outline. First of all, I want to demonstrate the piezoelectric effect on the so-called alpha-quartz. And we start with an experiment on a macroscopic scale. Then we go over to the alpha-quartz on the microscopic scale in order to describe the little bit the physics behind this very important solid body effect. And then I will give you an explanation of the direct and also the reciprocal piezoelectric effect. And behind both effects that are used in sensor and actuator technologies, there is a very important physical quantity that is called electric polarization. And I want to show you how you can also calculate this electric polarization within a simplified unit cell of the alpha quartz. Yeah, and then I will conclude my presentation. Let me start with the alpha quartz as shown on the left side of the slide. You see a crystal structure that can also be found in nature, but is also it can also be grown in a hydrothermal conclaves. So we call it a so-called low temperature modification and also low quartz. Low quartz equals alpha quartz. That means that we have a special structure, a crystal structure below 573 centigrade degree, which represents the Curie temperature of this material. The alpha quartz belongs to the trigonal crystal system. A crystal system we use for the characterization of the three-dimensional classification of crystals. Now, let's have a closer look to this axis, red colored here called Z. This axis represents the so-called crystallographic main axis, also called optic axis. In a later slide, we will see why is it called optic axis. Now, we have three furthermore axes. These axes are called polar axes. Why are they called polar? Now, a polar axis connects two opposing edges of the hexagonal prism. That's the first thing you can see in the left side in this picture. And the opposing edges, they are not equivalent. That's why they are called all polar. The small surfaces marked with A and B are present at the rear edge, e.g. assigned to the axis X2, but they are missing at the opposite edge. And this non-symmetry plays an important role for the further discussions. Now, I assume now that I cut out a piece of this quartz crystal perpendicular to the optical axis Z. What we then get is so-called non-deformed hexagonal quartz prism. If we have a closer look to the axis, you see again the optic axis Z and also the three polar axes X1, X2, and X3. If I apply now a mechanical pressure load, for example, in direction X1, then I will realize an experiment that there are several electric charges are generated at the surface of this material. We have positive and negative charges. We talk about the generation of piezoelectricity, but what's the meaning of this piezoelectricity? How can it be generated? Now, in order to get a more detailed look, we have to discuss the structure of alpha quartz on a microscopic or molecular scale. If I have a closer look to this material, the quartz material is realized by SiO4 4 minus tetrahedrons. What does it mean? We have a silicon atom in the center of the tetrahedron, which is surrounded by 4 oxygen atoms. Now, in a really ideal state, we can talk about a covalent bond. That means that the silicon atom centered has 4 electron pair bonds to each oxygen atom. That means if we pay attention to the octet rule, that each oxygen atom shows 1 minus charge. So we have, to the outwards, we have 4 minus electron charges. Now, in another way, we can also assume that the tetrahedron is realized by a completely a perfect ionic bond. That means we have the silicon atom in the center, which has 4 positive charges, and that is surrounded by the 4 oxygen atoms, which is in the ionic bond, shows each oxygen atom shows 2 minus charges. So, but in nature, you don't find ideal covalent bonds or ideal ionic bonds. The real world exists in between. In order to find out what we can assume now for the further discussions, I have a closer look to the electronegativity Xi of a chemical element. The electronegativity is a measure for its ability to gain electrons in a molecule. Now, if we have a look to the electronegativity of the silicon, that equals 1.8, and of oxygen, that equals 3.5. That means we have a difference of electronegativity equals 1.7. If you have a look to scientific textbooks in chemistry or physical chemistry, you can see that assuming an electronegativity difference of 1.7 results in the partial ionic character of 50%, which can be assumed for the SiO bond. Now, this is now one really important result, which I use in order to explain the piezoelectricity in a more easier way. So I assumed that the SiO4 tetrahedron exists in a pure ionic bond within the SiO4 4 minus tetrahedron. Okay. First of all, I want to build up now the hexagonal unit cell of the alpha quartz. What does it mean? We have our 3 polar axes, x1, x2, and x3. The first silicon ion is placed in plane of the slide. here, and the next silicon ion is placed on the X2 axis, but the silicon ion 2, the distance is going to the negative Z direction. So that means that the silicon ion 2 is below the silicon ion 1, and the silicon ion 3 is also below the silicon ion 2, which is also below the silicon ion 1. That means that we have just like a twisting in direction of the Z axis or optic axis. Now the same we have with the oxygen ions, which I will show here. And since we have three silicon ions with four positive charges, we need six oxygen ions, so that there is no charge towards the outside of the crystal structure. That means we have to apply three more oxygen ions, and you see that the structure is just like twisting into the plane along the Z axis. This twisting is responsible for the optical rotation of incoming light. That means that the polar plane of the light will be rotated along the Z axis, why it's also called optical axis. Now, this complete structure, if you have a look to the geometry, you will see a hexagonal unit cell. This hexagonal unit cell is a little bit deformed because of the real structure. What I will do in the next step is to simplify this structure a little bit. That means that I shift the oxygen ions in that way that they are laying behind each other along the Z direction, that you will see in the next slide. We have now two oxygen ions on each polar axis sitting behind each other, and we have our three silicon ions also. Now we have also a hexagonal prism structure, which is shown here in a red color. In the next step, I will now do the switch to explain the piezoelectric effect as well as the longitudinal and as well as the transversal effect. Let's start with longitudinal direct piezoelectric effect. Now I assume this simplified structure that is compressed by a mechanical pressure load along the X1 axis. You see that the hexagonal unit cell is deformed, in a deformed state. That means the upper silicon ion shifts between the two upper oxygen ions, and the lower oxygen ion shifts between the two lower silicon ions, resulting in a generated charge on the upper and lower electrode, which is combined with the polarization P. This polarization vector P will be a very important quantity later on, and can be calculated according to the symmetry of this simplified unit cell. Now, this means that the piezoelectric, that the polarization vector is in parallel to the direction of the mechanical pressure load, and we talk about a longitudinal effect. If I compress my piezoelectric unit cell from the left and the right side by a mechanical pressure load, then the silicon and oxygen ions on the left and right sides of the structure cell shift uniformly inwards. and their charges cancel each other. The upper silicon and lower oxygen ion of the unit cell are shifted outwards, resulting in a generated charge again on the upper and lower electrode. But now in the picture on the left side, we have a negative charge on the upper electrode. Now we have a positive charge on the upper electrode, and vice versa. And also there is a polarization vector that turns around by 180 degrees. Now the polarization vector is perpendicular to the direction of the mechanical pressure load, and we talk about a so-called transversal piezoelectric effect. This direct piezoelectric effect is that effect that we use in actuator technologies and in modern actuator devices today. The next one will be also very important effect, the so-called reciprocal piezoelectric effect, also divided into the longitudinal and transversal effect. Now we see our simplified unit cell again. Now I apply an electric voltage by a battery, and the lower electrode is connected with the positive pole of the battery, and the upper electrode is connected with the negative pole. That means that we have charges that are on these electrodes are resulting in an electric field vector over the unified simplified cell of the alpha quartz. Also, we can see a deformation of the simplified unit cell, and it means the two upper oxygen ions are somewhat attracted towards the lower electrode, and the two lower silicon ions are attracted towards the upper electrode because of the external charges on the electrodes. This results again in a compression that is parallel to the X1 axis, and there is also a polarization generated, a polarization vector that is in parallel with the direction of compression again. And it's also called the longitudinal reciprocal piezoelectric effect. Now, the last but not least, we just switch the direction of the poles, the connection to the upper and lower electrodes. Now, the lower electrode is connected with the minus pole, the upper electrode is connected with the plus a pole of the battery, and that means that we just turn around the electric field, and this results in a compression, as you can see on the unicell shown here in a red color. The upper two upper oxygen ions are attracted towards the upper electrode A, and the two lower silicon ions are attracted towards the lower electrode. The silicon and oxygen ions on the left and right side of the unit cell shift uniformly inwards. And the compression is now perpendicular to the polarization vector P, and we call it transversal effect. I think I did a mistake in the slide before. The direct piezoelectric effect is not used for actuator technologies. It is used for sensor technologies because I compress the piezoelectric element, and I I will realize generated charges that can be used on an electric side. Now, in this reciprocal piezoelectric effect, I apply an electric voltage and I can generate a deformation of the material which is used in actuator technologies. Now, behind this polarization vector, there is one quantity that is very important to understand, and I want to discuss a little bit this important physical quantity. It's the so-called electric polarization. I will start with the electric dipole moment. If we have two opposite charges that are distance by a distance vector d, we can define the electric dipole moment by the following equation. That means the electric dipole moment P equals the charge times the distance vector. If we now want to define the electric polarization vector, we assume a volume. Within this volume, we assume that there are existing different electric dipole moments shown here as an example. And if you take the mean value of all these vectors, you will have an all over electric polarization P, which equals the sum of each individual electric dipole moment within this volume divided by the volume of this cell. Now, with this information, we can go ahead to calculate the polarization vector within the simplified unit cell of the alpha-quartz material. Let's have a look again to our non-deformed configuration of the unit cell. And you see on the left side, I highlight up the silicon ions in a red color. Now I express these the electric charge by this silicon ions in on the right side by the charge Q. The same I do with the oxygen ions highlighted in a red color on the left side. I replace them by a charge minus Q. And we know that opposite charges can be described by an electric dipole moment. So if we see that, we have three dipole moments existing in this simplified unit cell of the alpha quartz, P1, P2, and P3. The geometric quantities in order to calculate the polarization have to be introduced. I will do that in the next slide. First of all, we have our three dipole moments, P1, P2, and P3, because there exists physical equation P equals Q times D. We can replace each electric dipole moment vector by the displacement vector D. I do that now. So we have three displacement vectors, D1, D2, D2, and D3. Now I introduce Cartesian coordinate systems with the unit vectors AEX and EY. And I will introduce some quantities A that equals the side length of the unit cell, and B and H are the so-called auxiliary quantities which are used for the calculation now. These geometric auxiliary quantities can be very easily described by the angle here shown at the side at the side A, and they are H is can be explained by A times the sine alpha and B equals A times cosine alpha. In the next step, I will calculate the total dipole moment within this unit cell, and it's only the summing up of the individual dipole moments pi. That means I sum up the individual distance vectors multiplied by the charge q. If I do that, I will see the individual vector components in x direction, expressed here in dependence of the auxiliary quantity b, and I have also the vector components in y direction, which are expressed here by the auxiliary quantity h and the side length of the unit cell A. If I now replace within these equations the individual direction components, I have a very easy mathematical expression, as well as for the x direction and for the y direction. And all that together leads to the calculation rule for the total dipole moment, which is very easy. It's q times the side length a, and in brackets 2 sine alpha minus 1. And you see we have only the unit vector ey that remains. Ex will vanish. And that is somewhat we have also seen some slides before, explaining the direct and the reciprocal piezoelectric effect. Now, in order to calculate now the electric polarization, the quantity I'm interested in, I have to divide the total dipole moment by the volume. Now, this equation is now used for the calculation of the polarization vector. Let's start with the non-deformed configuration of the unit cell. We see that the angle alpha equals 30 degrees. That means pi divided by 6. If I calculate now the electric polarization, I use our defining equation, the slide before, and I replace the I replace the angle alpha by pi divided by 6. This expression equals 1, and the bracket term results in 0, so that means there is no polarization within a non-deformed configuration of the unit cell. That is something we can also see in experiments with real quartz materials. And the next one is the mechanical pressure load acting along the y-axis. If we assume that, then the angle alpha is smaller than 30 degrees. That means it's smaller than a pi divided by 6. If I just take our equation for the electric polarization vector, I will see that the first term before the brackets is bigger than 0, and the term the first term in the brackets is smaller than 1. That means that the complete expression is smaller than 0, what results in a negative polarization along the y direction. That is also something we have already seen in the slides before when I explained the direct piezoelectric longitudinal effect. And now I will just we'll just apply mechanical pressure load along the x direction, and what we saw some slides before was the the change of the polarization direction by 180 degrees. And you can also calculate this by assuming that now the angle is bigger than pi divided by 6. That means in our calculation rule that the term, the first term in the brackets, is bigger than 1. And that means that the bracket term all together is bigger than 1 and we bigger than 0, and we have a positive polarization along the y-axis. Yeah. Now I just want to conclude my presentation here. The structure of alpha quartz and the corresponding crystal axis are shown on a macroscopic scale in order to explain the phenomenon of piezoelectricity. It necessitates the understanding of the molecular and the microscopic structure of alpha quartz. Both the direct and the reciprocal piezoelectric effect can be explained in a simple manner by assuming an ionic bond within the unit cell of alpha quartz and the electric dipole moment, and thus the electric polarization enable the physical understanding of this piezoelectric effect. And it's indeed, piezoelectricity is a very, very important solid body effect today used in so many actuator and sensor applications. I'm involved in so many projects concerned with piezoelectric materials and actuator and sensor technologies. And it's a pleasure for me to share and to bring my knowledge to you and to all the people who are interested in piezoelectricity. And I hope you had some interesting minutes now with my presentation and my short lecture. And thank you very much for your attention. And if there are any questions, you can ask me now, or you can contact me by phone, by fax, or by mail, as shown in my last picture. Thank you very much.